Chapter 25. The Voice of the Mole. On November 4th, after two failed efforts in Moscow, the third attempt by the CIA to obtain the file was successful. As Mr. Pym had promised, he showed up at the designated rendezvous and handed over the file. The precious file arrived in Washington in several carefully wrapped packages, enough to fill a medium-sized suitcase. It was guarded every step of the way on its secret journey from Moscow to the FBI. Mr. Pym had insisted that one package be marked "Do Not Open," and that it be held until he himself was safely out of Moscow. The FBI did not know why Sherbakov had mysteriously marked the package this way. Although the counterintelligence agents were itching to see what was inside, it was decided to abide by his instructions. The mystery package was not opened. In less than 2 weeks, they knew, the Russian would come out of Moscow and explain the contents. The file contained the all-important notebook in which Sherbakov had copied all the details of the mole's dealings with the KGB and later the SVR over a period of 10 years. While the agents waited for Mr. Pym to arrive, there was work to be done. At the FBI laboratory on the third floor of FBI headquarters, the techs began a detailed forensic examination of the file. The contents were carefully dusted for fingerprints, but there were no useful prints. In addition, every document, message, letter, and envelope was photographed. There were translations needed, required because much of the material was in Russian. Sherbakov had managed to compile an inventory and description in Russian of every document, 6,000 pages in all, that had been passed to Moscow by the mole. The list would have to be translated back into English. The file included the communications exchanged by the mole and the Russians over the course of 10 years, and the titles of the documents he had given to the KGB. But the detailed notes taken by Sherbakov described them in sufficient detail so that the FBI could retrieve them from its own files, as well as in some cases from the files of the NSA and the CIA. The counterintelligence agents then began the painstaking job of matching the titles of the documents in Sherbakov's notebook with the originals in the FBI files. A preliminary look at the files offered some tantalizing clues to the identity of the mole, but nothing conclusive. More was needed. Next, FBI analysts began a thorough examination of the file, searching for clues that would confirm the identity of the mole at last. The letters and contents nowhere identified the mole by name or by organization. He was referred to as Ramon, or B, or Ramon Garcia. Nevertheless, the counterintelligence agents believed that Gray Deceiver, the CIA officer Brian Kelly, would soon be arrested. 10 days after handing the file to the CIA, the $7 million spy made it back to the U.S., for the last time. On November 14th, Mr. Pym was in Washington, meeting with Rochford and other FBI counterintelligence agents. As instructed, the FBI had not opened the envelope marked "Do Not Open." Now Sherbakov said, "Open it. There's a fingerprint of your guy on a bag and a voice recording." It was 14 years earlier in 1986 that the unidentified mole had given the KGB the number of a payphone in Northern Virginia that he arranged to call at an agreed time on August 18th. Unknown to the mole, the KGB agent who answered recorded part of their conversation. Now the FBI had the tape. The Russians had kept everything. Even one of the plastic trash bags that the mole had used to wrap the documents that he left for the KGB in dead drops around Washington. Mr. Pym explained how he came to possess the bag. Inside the mystery package, in addition to the tape recording, was an ordinary black plastic trash bag, of the kind that suburban homeowners use to dispose of leaves or garbage. When Hansen filled a dead drop, he would wrap the documents and disks in a plastic trash bag and tape it up to waterproof it and protect it from the elements. Then he would wrap the whole package in a second plastic bag. Under normal procedure, Mr. Pym said, someone else opened the bags. He would then receive a pile of documents that had been handled first by others. Only once did they drop off the outer bag with the documents, he said. When he removed the outer bag, he assumed that the only person who had touched the inner bag was himself and Ramon. So he carefully put the inner bag in an envelope. The plastic bag was to prove one of the two crucial items in the file that Sherbakov removed from the KGB's first chief directorate, its foreign espionage arm. The other was the tape recording. The bag was sent to the FBI lab to check for fingerprints, but the bag would have to be handled with extreme care, and processing it for prints was going to take a while. In the meantime, Rochford, with two colleagues, Michael Wagspack and Tim Berezne, adjourned to a room in the basement of the FBI to listen to the tape. Wagspack, known as Wags, grew up in the Cajun country near New Orleans and was regarded as one of the best counterintelligence agents in the FBI. Berezne was also an experienced counterintelligence agent and a section chief at FBI headquarters. Now, at last, Rochford was sure the fate of Gray Deceiver, Brian Kelly, was sealed. The FBI counterintelligence agents were still convinced that the CIA officer was the mole. As the FBI agents settled back to listen, they were sure they were about to hear the voice of Brian Kelly. The tape rolled, and the FBI agents could hardly wait to hear it. The long mole hunt was about to be over. To their utter consternation, the voice that boomed out from the speakers was not that of Brian Kelly. The agents were stunned and chagrined at the unexpected turn of events. 3 years lost. All that effort, and now, just as Rochford was sure that the mole was within his grasp, the shocking revelation, on a 14-year-old snippet of magnetic tape, that the Bureau had been chasing the wrong man. Brian Kelly was innocent. His career at the CIA had suffered great damage that could not be undone and repaired. But if the voice on the tape was not Brian Kelly, then who was it? Wagspack recalled his frustration. I kept listening and I said, I know that voice, the inflection. I know that voice, but I can't put it with anybody. That voice sounds familiar. We broke off that day, still unsure.